two settlements which you have completed, there is one more feature which is associated with the Indian agriculture during the British rule. That feature is known as the commercialization of agriculture. Commercialization of agriculture means when the land, when the cultivable land is not used for the production of food crops, but it is used for the production of those crops which are needed for the industrialized Britain, which are needed to feed those crops which are needed to feed the industries, are those crops for which there is the market availability, the crops which will give huge profits to the Britishers, because there is the ready market which is available for those crops. Okay, so various crops were encouraged by the Britishers, and that land was used for the production of those cash crops, those commercial crops which was previously used for the production of food crops. So among those important crops which were encouraged by the Britishers, first important crop was the cotton. Then there were other crops like indigo, okay, tea, coffee, okay. Then you have rubber, jute. These crops were encouraged by the Britishers and they were exported to the Britain or to the Europe. Okay, so this commercialization of agriculture, actually it is related with the industrialization. It is the feature of the industrially growing. It is the feature of the industrially growing country. During those days, during the first and the second half of the 19th century, Britain was going through the phase of industrial revolution, whereas the India was going through the phase of industrial backwardness, deindustrialization. Okay, so unfortunately, if commercialization of agriculture is the feature of industrially growing country, it was not India which was at that time growing industrially, it was Britain. It was Britain which was growing industrially. That means this commercialization of agriculture started in India not to feed the Indian industries, but it was meant to feed the British industries. Okay, the Britishers wanted to transform India into the land for the raw materials which were used by them for their industries which were located in the Britain. And they again wanted to transform this land, this country, into the market for their finished products. These are two important features. These two important features, you will see all the way till 1947. Raw material, India was the country wherein the huge number of raw materials were supplied to the industries which are located in Britain, and from there, when the goods were manufactured, those finished goods were again transported to India, you know, because it also served their market purpose for those products, right? So this commercialization of agriculture was motivated by those factors. Okay, this was motivated by those factors, and continuously the Britishers encouraged the production of those crops which were needed, you know, by the British industries. So I will give an example. For example, the Department of Agriculture, which was established during the British India, it was not established for the welfare of the Indian peasants or the welfare of the Indian agriculture. It was established due to the pressure which was imposed upon the Britishers by the Manchester Cotton Textile Association. I will give you one more example. In 1839, the court of directors, the governing body of the East India Company, the court of directors, they sent some 12 American cotton planters India in order to teach the local population how to produce the good quality of cotton and how to clean the cotton. So they were interested in, they were interested for their own profits, for their own trading purposes. And this this is how the British India, they always encouraged the production of those crops which were either needed for their industries, or those crops wherein for those the market was readily available, whether the American market or the European market. For example, tea, coffee, there was a great demand for these products, or the jute in the American as well as the other European markets. So this commercialization of agriculture, it was never beneficial for the Indian population. It was beneficial only for the British planters. It was beneficial only for the British planters. Or to some extent, it also gave profits to some kind of intermediaries. The intermediaries, like the middlemen or the money lenders who were given money to the peasants, those money lenders got benefited through this policy of commercialization of agriculture. And what happened, due to this commercialization of agriculture, the area, the land area which was previously under the cultivation of food crops, that area got reduced, and the area now which got, that land area which now got under this the cultivation of these commercial crops, that area got expanded up to 300%. उस land जो वो cultivable area जो है उसको उन्होंने जो है expand किया, that got expanded. Such was the policy of these Britishers. And when you are transforming the land, when you are transforming the land which was under the food crops into the kind of non-food crops, so it ultimately gave nothing to the Indian farmers, because they only needed subsistence kind of farming. At that time the population was highly increasing due to the increase in the population. They were highly needing the food crops which were not there, because the land was now used for the non-food crops, and that gave a huge setback to the Indian farmers who were not having enough even to eat as far as the food crops are concerned. Okay, जब आप वही land जो है non-food crops के लिए use कर रहे हो, तो उस चक्कर में जो है वो Indian farmers जो उसको खाने के लिए कुछ नहीं मिलता था, and as a result you will see this was something which gave contribution to the famines and the starvation kind of things. Okay, so this was the result of this commercialization of agriculture. Okay, so there is one more aspect which is related with the same, with this, with the Indian agriculture, that is rural indebtedness, right? Rural indebtedness, that is also associated with the Indian agriculture. Rural indebtedness, this is what is known as, when the Indian peasant is thrown towards the money lenders, sahukars, jo waha pe mahajan wagaira jo hote hain rural India mein, jo unko high interest rates pe loans wagaira dete hain, short term mein long term loans, and wo ek trap jaisa banta hai. So under that trap the Indian peasant falls. And due to those high interest rates which are charged by the unregulated money lenders, those were unregulated. Now they were not controlled by the government, they were in fact encouraged by the government. These unregulated money lenders, they used to charge high interest rates upon the Indian peasant. Okay, so due to the illiteracy of the Indian peasant, due to the ignorance of the Indian peasant, due to the various forged signatures, etc., this Indian peasant was thrown into the trap by this sahukar, by the mahajans or the money lenders, which led to something, which led to this indebtedness, karzdari. And that indebtedness, that also proved very harmful for the Indian peasant, for the Indian cultivator. Okay, so the, as far as the causes which are responsible for this rural indebtedness are concerned, it is the high land revenue demand. High land revenue demand, whether in the Riyotwari settlement or in the Zamindari settlement or the Mahalwari settlement, jo maine aapko padhaya, so in those settlements, the Indian peasant was to pay the high land revenue either to the government or to the Zamindar or to the intermediary, which was in between, you know. In case of permanent settlement, it was directly the Zamindar who was the owner of that land. In case of Riyotwari settlement, there was no one between the peasant and the government, and the peasant had to pay directly to the government officials. Riyotwari settlement. In case of Mahalwari settlement, there was also a feature wherein, you know, this tax was given to the local landlord. So those land revenue settlements, they were marked by this feature that there was a high land revenue demand. There was the high land revenue demand which was charged from this Indian peasant. Now Indian peasant, this land revenue demand was mostly charged in the form of cash. And there was a definite date. So by the time, you know, the date was fixed and you have to pay the revenue, revenue demand, tax demand by a particular date which was fixed. Okay, so if you are not paying the revenue to the government, so you will be evicted from your land. Your land will be confiscated. Due to those measures, this peasant was thrown into the mercy of the local money lender, sahukar, mahajan. तो उसको वहाँ से जो है लेना पड़ती थी, तो उसको अपनी land थोड़ी बहुत जो है वो बेचनी पड़ती थी, या वो कर्जदारी के लिए जो है उधर जाता था, भाई हमें जो है आप इतने time के लिए जो है कुछ ये loan दे दो, तो जब तक हम आपको loan जो है loan provide ये वापस नहीं करेंगे, तब तक आप उसको जो हमारे land को है गिरवी रखो, mortgage. So गिरवी रखने के चक्कर में जो है उसकी लैंड जो है कभी भी नहीं वहां से छूट जाती थी. सो वो लैंड जो है अल्टीमेटली आहिस्ता आहिस्ता करके सारा उस मनी लैंडर सोहकार के चक्कर में जो है वो लैंड चला जाता था. दैट इज, यू नो, दैट अगेन लीड्स टू फ्यूचर दैट इज नोन एज ग्रोथ ऑफ एग्रीकल्चरल लेबर. एग्रीकल्चरल लेबर, यहाँ पे एग्रीकल्चरल लेबर जो होता है ना, ये वो लेबर होता है जिसकी अपनी जमीन नहीं होती है. अब जो दूसरी की जमीन पे जो है वो काम करता है, because he was not having his own land now. And when his land was taken away by the money lenders, so by the sahukars, so that land, you know, he was now forced to do the cultivation in others' land. That led to the feature that is known as the agricultural labor. The growth of agricultural labor is the result of these policies. Okay, so this high land revenue demand led to this feature of rural indebtedness, because once you are charged the high revenue, you have to do something. Either you have to sell your land, either you have to go to the, you know, this money lender for the loans, and wo aapko loan karta hai, provide. Okay, so aap yahan se jo hai, matlab aap illiterate ho. So due to your illiteracy, you are not able to know how much interest he's charging upon me, on what kind of paper document he has taken my thumb or the signature. Okay, so this is something which is highly portrayed in the novels of Premchand, na, Munshi Premchand. He has given worked upon those aspects of rural indebtedness, the theme of his novels, the theme of his this dastans vagaira, jo afsane vagaira, jo afsane Munshi Premchand vagaira ke hai. So the theme of those novels is rural indebtedness. Okay, so that is mostly associated with these features. You will see there that how that cultivator is not able to know how much he has charged upon me, you know, how he is being forced by the money lender with his shrewd activities, wo uski jo chalaki vagaira hoti hai, theek hai na. So again, there are also the social and religious customs, of the rural India, which also contributed to the growth of rural indebtedness, because they were holding some, you know, as far as the marriage ceremonies or other kind of functions, religious functions are concerned, they used to spend huge amount upon those ceremonies and functions. So those functions also, they needed money now. So where from they would get the money? They will get the money readily from the ruler landlord, the ruler money lender, or the sahukar. So again, he was, he was taking money without having any plan B that how he will, you know, वो उसको कैसे चुका पाएगा उस कर्ज को. So then the lack of modernity of agriculture, because Britishers didn't do anything seriously as far as the welfare of agricultural sector is concerned. For example, they didn't do anything serious for the irrigation activities. They didn't do anything serious for the regulation of those money lenders. Okay, so such kind of activities also led to the growth of rural indebtedness. Okay, we no doubt the Britishers enacted what is known as the Usurious Act. Usurious Act, it was amended from time to time for, in 1874 or something, it was amended also. Usurious Act, then later on, during the beginning of 20th century, they also enacted the Cooperative Societies Act. Cooperative Societies Act. But these two acts, Usurious Act and the Cooperative Societies Act, they were both ineffective. And mostly, it were the Britishers, it were the courts, it was the police who was always in favor of the money lender, was always in favor of the sahukar. So both the British policies and their encouragement to the money lenders led to this problem of rural indebtedness. Okay, led to this problem of rural indebtedness. So this was all about these two features of commercialization of agriculture and rural indebtedness.